So we're here, I'm here with several wonderful students, six wonderful, highly talented students that I have worked with at Harwood to share a journey that we've been on and what we know about how to have high quality in-person conversations, and especially how to have high quality conversations online. And the students are really going to be leading much of this workshop, and they're going to be facilitating a small online discussion. We invite everyone to join in, and we'll be sharing the practices that we've learned to adopt as we go along.
So today we are really going to hone in on this question of how can we create virtual classrooms that are highly engaging and grounded in mutual respect, collaboration, and trust. So we are all Harwood students, and last year we were all part of a class with Kathy Cadwell that focused on classroom dialogue through the Harkness pedagogy. And we were having lots of discussions and presenting around the state when COVID happened, and we decided to try to have discussions online. So most of this presentation is based on what we learned during those months after March. So I'm Mary Smith. This is my second year working with Kathy Cadwell on all this work. And in my spare time, I also like to play field hockey, and I'm also a ski instructor during the winter. And the season just finished out, and that's me on the left with the student that I got to work with this year. So it was really fun.
Hi, I'm Maya George. I'm a junior at Harwood. I've been involved in Harkness for 2 years with Kathy, and I've been helping her teach some courses this year on dialogue, which has been really fun. When I'm not at school, I like to watch Gilmore Girls with my sister, and here you can see me on a hike at camp, which I really like.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jay Fuller. I'm 17 years old, and I'm a junior at Harwood Union High School. Throughout my years at high school, I've become super passionate about students advocating for their own education. And because of this, I love being involved in the craziness of the Harkness pedagogy, where students drive the conversation. When I'm not in school, you can find me playing basketball, training as barista at PK Coffee, and spending time outdoors with family and friends.
Hi guys, I'm Anna Alberghini, and I'm so excited to be here today. So I am a junior at Harwood Union High School, and this is also my second year working with Kathy on Harkness. When I'm not in school, I love to travel, and I also intern at a law office in Waterbury. And I really love Harkness because I love expanding on new ways to learn and helping integrate that into my school community.
Hi, everyone. My name is Allie Brooks. I'm also a junior at Harwood. In my free time, I love to play field hockey, sing, spend time with my family and friends. And I took that class with Kathy last year, and ever since then, I've been really involved in the Harkness pedagogy at Harwood. And I love the opportunity to kind of take charge of my own learning and help other students do that as well.
Hello, I'm Mason. I'm a senior. I've been working with Harkness in and out of the strategies class since sophomore year. And that time I've really come to believe in the main concept of Harkness, which is the one that does the work, does the learning. And I want to like continue spreading that belief after I'm out of Harwood.
Thanks, Mason. So you heard these students mention the term Harkness, or the Harkness pedagogy. That's a particular type of learning where students work together to drive the conversation. This workshop is really not about Harkness. We're really going to be sharing our experiences about how to have high quality discussions face-to-face, and most specifically online. Harkness, they don't have to be Harkness discussions. We're going to be sharing some general principles that we have just learned. These are words that really have rung true with me. The foundation of all high quality discussion really is based in relationships and trust. And as Brené Brown says here, that trust is earned in the smallest of moments. When we think about developing trust in our classrooms and a climate of collaboration and safety where kids feel comfortable taking risks, that's the foundation of all successful and high quality dialogue. And this sort of dialogue, I think, demands new roles for students and teachers. And we're going to be talking about that today.
So one of the things that's important to think about with online dialogues is what are the obstacles, because there are definitely some new things that have come up in the past year that have made it a little bit harder to discuss these topics in an online classroom setting. There are certainly advantages, but we're going to start off with this short video of Harwood teachers showing us some obstacles to an online discussion.
So have you ever seen any of these behaviors before?
So welcome everyone, and it's great to see you. What we're gonna do to start today is we're gonna review a little bit from your reading last night of lesson three about the character of Themistocles, okay? So can someone start off for me and just tell me a little bit about the character of Themistocles?
Well, I certainly noticed when I was, just to cite a text reference on page 23, that Themistocles was a liar. He boldly lied to the people when he tried to get them to go onto the ships, and he said, trust in the walls of wood. I can't imagine a leader who would lie to their people like that.
That's very interesting, Kathy, and it's very perceptive of you. It seems like that tells us a little bit about his character, that he would be willing to lie to his people.
I'll be right back.
I think he was, I agree, Kathy, that he was dishonest. He persuaded by lying. Like when he went to the oracles to try to convince the people to trust in the wood, and how that could be perceived as, do we stay within the walls of where we're at, or do we actually go into the ship?
Coming.
I wasn't quite sure, but yes, I agree. It was dishonest.
Thanks, Vicky. That's another good addition to tell us a little bit more about his character. Let's see. Nick, could you add, I was wondering if you could maybe share a detail that you picked up from the reading about Themistocles' character. You can't hear? Okay. Okay. We'll go to somebody else. Okay. Let's see. Kate, could you tell us a little bit about Themistocles' character? Are you there, Kate? Kate? Looks like she's, okay, I'll try with somebody else here.
I don't know if you have seen any of those sorts of behaviors when you have tried to have online discussions, but I know that many teachers at Harwood certainly have.
So one exercise we're gonna do is we wanna know what challenges you as teachers have encountered using online discussions. And we'd like you to put them in the chat, like think of just a few comments or something that you thought of during that video, something you've experienced in your virtual classroom.
I start talking and forget to unmute.
I can hear students talking to each other on Facebook.
Internet issues!
Students who leave immediately after attendance.
Little siblings bobbing the class.
Multiple people trying to talk at the same time.
Pets are wonderful, but sometimes distracting.
Eating!
Students not turning on their cameras.
It's difficult to read body language when talking about tough topics.
Glitching screens!
Students are in chaotic environments that cause disruptions when they try to ask questions. Teachers not being aware why students choose to keep their cameras off. I feel all alone sometimes.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I don't know, as you're scrolling through these, if you see anything that you haven't written that resonates with your experience. Losing the windows, cameras are never on, people eating, students coming to class in their bedrooms, having people wear clothes. That was one thing that's been brought up before. It wasn't mentioned on this pets in the window. Absolutely, when we operate in an online world, it really is a new world. So I'm gonna close this chat, but no, we're gonna be saving the chat and send it out with a variety of materials at the end of this session. But challenges from the student's perspective. This is a list that kids created to share with teachers. What's hard for them?
Okay, so the first thing that we noticed when we were brainstorming challenges that we had experienced while having online discussions was that speaking up online can be more difficult. I think that when you have like a barrier of technology, it can definitely be like a little bit more nerve-wracking because it adds a lot of extra challenges just on top of already like speaking out in a group can sometimes be really scary for a lot of students.
Yeah, definitely. A second challenge is it is immensely easier to lose focus and not participate in online discussions than it is in person. I don't know about you guys, but I have a MacBook as my computer. So like if I see a message pop up, it's super easy to just like turn and like want to respond to my message rather than like zeroing in on what's going on in the discussion.
So our next bullet point is that there are sometimes technical difficulties that can get in the way of learning. And I think that we experienced some technical difficulties today and almost like every Zoom I'm in, you know, it's a big challenge that we face.
Definitely. It is hard to connect with people through a screen and feel the energy in the room. During a hardness discussion in person, you can definitely like feel the energy start to build and pick up. And it's a lot harder through the screen, which can cause people to be nervous or not focus. And just the loss of energy sometimes is a huge challenge that students face.
So this one I think is a real big challenge, especially when we're having active discussions, and that is without body language, interruptions are frequent. I think this is a really important one. You know, through the screen, you can't really see when people are like leaning in to speak up into a discussion. And so I think that makes it so interruptions are a lot more frequent because we can't read each other's body language.
Certainly, and another one is there's less accountability for students. This is a huge one because students have to become accountable to themselves and say, you know what, this is a time where I'm going to focus and I'm going to drive my own learning. Whereas in a classroom, you know, you're accountable to your teacher who's like standing right there and watching you, and through Zoom, the teacher's watching you, but for a student, you can have your camera off. So there's just less boundaries and less accountability. So it really turns the focus to the student, and it drives the student to say, hey, I want to drive my own learning.
So the next one is the online experience is not the same for every person as the environment is different. So opposed to being in one classroom all together, I think it's a big challenge that everyone's in a different environment and their distractions, their workspace may be different. So I think that definitely makes it difficult.
So we're offering these up, thank you, Anna and Jay, to share with you, because this is a list that these kids brainstormed. What are the challenges that they have? And, you know, we might compare this with our list, you know, what teachers just brainstormed. Certainly there are some overlaps and yet some very different challenges when you're a student in an online classroom rather than if you're a teacher.
So, but instead we're moving towards what happens in a high quality discussion. So what do you see happening? It could be these kind of virtual body language things. So it's muting, unmuting, are people using chat, all of that. Mm-hmm. What comments do you hear? Like probing questions. Is it just people, you know, are no questions being asked and people are just want to say what they think? And what is the emotional time? Are people checked out? Or are they really paying attention? Which kind of, yeah. So what do you see happening in a high quality discussion?
Yeah. So thank you. What we're going to invite you to do, to think for a minute and visualize when you are in a high quality discussion, face-to-face or online, what do you see? What do you see happening? We're inviting everyone to write in. This is a Google Doc that you have access to. What do you see happening? What do you hear? What sorts of comments do you hear? Student to teacher, student to student, for example. And how would you characterize the emotional tone or climate of the classroom? So we're going to invite people right now to add to this document. You all have access, students and teachers, all participants, but really focus on specifics. What do you see? What does it look like? What do you hear? What does it sound like? What sorts of comments? And what the emotional tone of the classroom or the climate of the classroom, it feels like, or I see what I observe. Thank you. We saw in the video spoof that the Harwood teachers did some of the things that some of the behaviors that maybe we don't want to see in an online discussion. But what are the things that we want to see, that we want to hear in a high quality discussion, either face-to-face or online? And what is the emotional tone of the group? So this is an exercise that I have done with students. I've asked them these same questions. What do you see happening? Engagement in different forms, breakout rooms, Google Docs, chats, students nodding or shaking their head, indicating whether or not they understand, paying attention to other students. And I might ask, well, what does that look like? But eye contact, leaning forward, facing forward, unmuting to participate. Another thing about leaning in and the body language. What do you hear? Lots of questions. Everyone's voices included, shared airtime, both probing and clarifying questions. This is a really interesting comment in the middle of that second column. The rhythm of different speakers allows many to be involved, each talking for long enough to express some deep stuff, at least a minute, but not so long as to take up too much air. That's the dynamics of the table. I think that's a powerful observation, and that's true online and face-to-face. Probing, clarifying questions. The climate of the classroom is what underlies, it's really the pillars, I think, that forms the foundation to allow those brave conversations to take place. I love that positive tension in the air. People are hanging on to each other's words and listening for ways that their own thinking is challenged and expanded. This is a lovely list. So these are aspirational, right? This is what we would want to happen. And I'd urge you to have your kids do this as an exercise also. So how do we get there, and what are some of the techniques and strategies that we can use?
So our first norm that we've kind of, or our first practice that we have is to invite students to log on early and chat with you. And this kind of just like helps create a safe and a kind of healthy environment where students don't feel like they're gonna be judged. They don't feel like they are too stressed out about it. It really kind of just gives them that peace of mind. And then the second one is to begin with an icebreaker. So this is kind of similar in that it kind of just makes it a more relaxed environment. It's not as stressful, or it's not as kind of tense for students. And it's also a really good way to connect with people. A lot of people said that it's hard to connect over Zoom, and it kind of feels like you're not really having a discussion with people. So an icebreaker can be a really great way to make that connection even over a virtual space. And then the next one is to use the chat as a tool to get people thinking about ideas. So this is one way you can actually utilize this online learning environment and use it to your advantage. I know it can be really easy to like look at all the negatives of this, but it's also important to remember that there are positives too. So the chat can be a great way to use that, like we just used it earlier in this presentation. And it can also be great to privately chat with students, you know, if they're having a little trouble or if they're not speaking out as much, but you sense that they might have some great ideas, they're just not really feeling comfortable with that. That can be a great tool to use. And then the last one is to monitor your airtime as a teacher. So kind of know your class and based on that, decide your role in the discussion. You know, it's kind of easy to tell pretty quickly how high quality the discussion is going to be. So if you can tell that all your students are really engaged, they're really going to be having a good discussion, you can just step back and really don't need that big of a role in it. Then again, of course, there's also classes that are definitely going to need more help, need more teacher engagement. But it's really important to not treat every class the same, to kind of assess where your class is at and go based off of that.
Let me mention one thing. The first one on the list is have students establish norms. When we go into our discussions, you're going to be introduced to some norms that these kids developed. And I also think that's critical, is that kids are involved along with you as the teacher in co-constructing the norms for the discussions. Ali, that was wonderful. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
So another thing to think about is to encourage questions rather than answers, and model and encourage risk taking. When students, especially online, it's hard to speak out because they might feel like they're just talking to a screen or people that they don't feel as connected to. It's harder to create that brave space on an online environment. So when the teacher is modeling that, it gives students, especially younger students, a nice example of what they can do, and it just creates a nice model for the space that we're creating online. And then another thing that we've found is really helpful is to end the class with a group debrief, thinking about what we as individuals each learned during the day, and then also how that contributed to the group and how the group performed when we all combined our knowledge. What do we need to work on? And then what else can the teacher do to help the students? At the end, we often ask students to give shout outs to one another for their contributions to build those relationships and the trust between each other. And then to practice with short and sweet before deep and difficult. Don't dive into those really deep, probing, timeless and timely questions. Start out with like an icebreaker or some clarifying short questions, and then students will naturally be able to move into the realm of probing and deeper thought.
Mm-hmm. So full disclosure, the students came up with most of the things on this list as advice for us as teachers. And when we were thrown into lockdown last year, like all of us, I was leading a class on dialogue, and we had to go from dialogue in person to dialogue online. And so we had to start from the beginning, constructing norms and figuring out how to make this work. And we probably had 15 very in-depth, high-value online discussions, but we had to create it from the beginning and build it from the ground up together.
At this workshop, attendees broke into groups to discuss an excerpt from Robin DiAngelo's White Fragility, and the Harwood students each facilitated a breakout group. We invite you to choose a similar text to try out some of the norm setting and discussion facilitation tools the students have shared in this video.
So let me welcome you back and just say, I was not in any of these breakout rooms. I think you guys had all the fun. Let me just see a show of hands. How many of you learned something new today or had the chance to hear from another perspective that you hadn't thought about before? Show me by putting a thumbs up. Okay. All right. I see some virtual thumbs up and some other thumbs up. That's wonderful. Well, Allie and Mason are going to take us through our final sort of activity. I want to thank the facilitators for having the courage to take on this task and to read this chapter and engage themselves in this deep work, and all of you to begin to deal with the content of the stuff that Robin DiAngelo brings up in her reading. And you know, this takes courage. This is long-term work. It's important work, just as learning to teach online, listening deeply to our students, letting students step forward and drive the conversation, and investigating new roles for students and teachers takes courage for all of us to learn how to step back so that we can help kids learn how to step up. So Mason and Allie, why don't you take us through this last piece?
We're going to be doing a Jamboard about how we can use strategies and tech tools to create engagement and deepen online discussions. We touched on this briefly in my group. I think Annie mentioned something about using the chat with people who aren't comfortable, and balancing that with facilitators reading that out loud.
Thank you. So let me just say, with regard to this question, when the kids and I were planning this, we talked about what do we want you as participants to take away from this discussion? And this is the question that the kids came up with. How can you and I as teachers use other strategies and tech tools to help create engagement and to deepen online discussions? So I'm going to open up this Jamboard. You all have access to it, and it's 2 pages, and inviting you to join the Jamboard and to add your thoughts and comments on this question. What are things that you've done well? What strategies have you used? What tech tools have you used? Sounds like Mason, you guys talked about it a little bit in your group, and I'd invite students also to add to this things that have worked for you that teachers have used, if you've been a student in a class. So we'll take some time to do that. Things that have been helpful, tech tools that create engagement, strategies that have worked. Maybe you've used it or you've been a student or a participant.
And if you're not familiar with Jamboard, this is one of the tech tools that can be helpful. You can, on the side, there's a few different things that you can do. You can create a sticky note, which most people have been doing. And you can also draw or add a picture or just like a text box. And then you can move them around, make them bigger, and change the color.
I'd love to invite anyone to anyone in the audience, students and teachers, or whether you were here from the beginning or whether you joined us late, just to talk about things that have been helpful for you.
Well, it's been really helpful for me, is, and I wrote this on the Jamboard, is when teachers give students a 5 to 10 minute break just to refresh and kind of think back on the ideas that were learned. And then you can come back with like a new perspective. You feel very comfortable back in the discussion instead of getting more prone to distraction without that break. That's really helpful for me.
I agree. I think when teachers embrace that everyone's sitting in their house all day looking at a screen, and maybe teachers are also feeling really overwhelmed with that, having a little break just brings like the humanity back into it.
Yes, thank you.
I'll say that I've been in groups where there's been a prompt for the chat, but then they decide that they say, give yourself time, do not hit enter. We're gonna do a chat fall. And so everyone, you know, I always think about sometimes people type faster or process faster. So you get a chance to do that. And then there's a countdown, 3, 2, 1, and then everyone hits enter and all the messages come down. And it just feels really inclusive in some ways that I was surprised by.
I want to make a couple observations about our list. A number of people have talked about silence and commenting that some of the facilitators use silence in a really thoughtful way. Silence is oftentimes uncomfortable for us. And I know that in my classes, we talk about this as students, and we talk about how to use silence as a way to encourage deep thinking. And there are techniques that you can use. Sometimes we call that a turn and talk. If you sense that the room is people are silent, instead of jumping in to save the conversation, which teachers often do, they feel there's tension in the room, no one's talking, so I have to say something. Encourage students to have a private chat with one another, or to, as some of you are suggesting, have a 3-minute think time. Turn off your cameras, all right? Think for 3 minutes, come back to the conversation. Or we say stop and write. Everyone, right? Take out a piece of paper and a pencil and let's just think, put some thoughts down on paper, reactions, bring those back to the conversation. Silence, being comfortable with silence and using silence as a learning tool is a challenge, but it's a wonderful one because it can be a productive way to learn how to be comfortable with one another. Any last thoughts, comments that anyone might want to add here?
One thing that I've done in the past to varying degrees of success is have students like put an answer to a question in chat and then like pick one of their responses and ask if anyone wants to like respond to that. And oftentimes that gets students thinking about like other students' work. And then sometimes even the student who said it will like be like, well, no, that's not what I meant. And so they're sort of playing off of each other.
Yeah, thank you, Abby. Yeah, using the private chat is a really interesting technique. A couple of people mentioned, you know, here the comment, using the chat to invite people in. When you're face-to-face, right? I can look Mary in the eye and I can give her a little clue that I'd love to have her speak next. Like, come on, Mary. But I can chat Mary, private chat, and say, Mary, I'm really looking forward to your comment. All right, come on. How about if you say this? And so you can have cross currents of conversations. Of course, the challenge is you don't want to have so many cross currents of conversations off screen that people's attention is diverted. That's why, if you noticed in the norms, we ask people to remain on the screen, all right, and to close other screens to give their full attention to the conversation at hand. Okay, these are some great, great ideas. They're not new to many of you. Maybe some are new to some people, and hopefully they'll give you some new things to think about here. So just as a way to end, I've been engaged in this work of having high quality, thoughtful discussions that are really grounded in mutual respect, collaboration, and trust for the last 5 years or so. And I've done it in a way where I'm using the knowledge that I can gain and the partnership that I can create with students to do this work. So here are some resources that I've pulled together that have been helpful for me. I'm sharing them all with you here. There are some articles I've written that have really been written with kids and about the kids that you have met today, some icebreaker activities, some materials for helping students ask good questions, some other articles on civil discourse. These are some pretty thoughtful articles. Some of you might be familiar with some of them, some norms as to how to have online and in-person conversations about difficult topics. And then finally, I have a website where I have all sorts of materials and videos about having discussions, specifically what we call Harkness discussions, but they don't have to be Harkness discussions, just high quality face-to-face or online discussions. And as we close out, I want to say a special thank you to the kids who are here today. Thank you, Jay and Mason and Allie and Mary and Maya and Anna, for taking time during school, online, after school, and sharing your time with us, sharing your expertise with us. Thank you to everyone who came today, and thank you for the Tarrant Foundation for making this possible. Susan.